भावना मैडम,
Amod, so you can put up your slide.
Yeah, you can start, Amod.
I think my slide is on or not? It's not, is it?
It is off. You have to pull it again.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, it has come.
Is it on?
Yes.
Is it back?
Yes.
Okay, wonderful. So should I start? Is the audio okay? Because there was some complaint about audio.
Perfect.
So, hello and welcome everybody, those who know me and those who do not, both. So we are here to get introduced to Ellora, one of the World Heritage Monuments. First of all, in the beginning, I would like to thank the tourism office and Safari Plus, Ms. Pallavi, for bringing up this great opportunity. So this is a new experience for me. I'm used to live shows usually, but this is something new and I hope to be up to it. So thank you very much. And thank you Venkateshan sir, thank you Bhavana madam, and thank you Ms. Parul. So without much ado, I think we should start. So this is about Ellora storytelling series of Ellora, as you know. So let me start with the first slide. Oops. This is a household announcement. Use this presentation with prior permission. Please keep your microphone and video closed till the end of presentation. Some photos are mine. Unfortunately, the monuments have not yet opened, so some I had to take it from internet. I don't know how to thank them, but so here I thank them for those who have put up the photographs on the internet. And so it's not going to be a great session, but I hope it. I try to make it up by talking and trying to answering questions, etc. Questions are very welcome at the end of the slide presentation. And those of you who know me, I can answer each and every question in the world. Except the problem is sometimes you may not like my answer. My answer could be, I don't know. And I think that's a good way to begin, because then that makes a possibility of knowing something that you don't know. So let's start without doing much ado. Okay, so this whole thing is about storytelling. Importance of storytelling is something that I don't need to tell every one of you. You know, if you are young, when you are young, your grandmas and your parents must have told you a lot of stories. But not only that, I have heard that when you go to China in old times, of course, in very old times, you would have inns where you would stay, you would eat. And the best inn was supposed to be the one in which there would be usually the lady who would be in charge, and the lady who would tell the best story in the night time. There was no TV, no internet, so telling story in the night time by that oil lamp, the one who could do that best was considered to be the best inn, and that would be most popular. And so also, as a guide, we try to tell you stories, and some of them are myths and some of them are related to facts too. So let's look at straight away get into this. Let's look at the evolution of name Ellora. That's a place. It's Elapur, Ellur, Verul, and Ellora. Elapur is then there is a small river nearby which begins there at a waterfall at cave number 29, and that is called El Ganga, and hence it became Elapur. And the king there those days was also called El Raja. Then it became Ellur, and then Verul in Marathi. And English, British couldn't pronounce it very well, so they went to Ellora. So it's in those of you who are not aware, it's in the located in the almost center part of Maharashtra at near Aurangabad, 27 kilometers from Aurangabad, which is the nearest railhead and airport. It is one of the earliest UNESCO World Heritage Site in India. So UNESCO declared 4 monuments in 1983 as a World Heritage Site. So first one is Ajanta, second is Ellora, third is Red Fort of Agra, and fourth is Taj Mahal. So that tells you how important these places really are, and amongst them is Ellora. So as you next slide, we'll go to this. Let's look at the difference between Ajanta and Ellora. So I think you've seen, some of you have seen the Ajanta presentation, or maybe you've seen Ajanta also. Ajanta and Ellora, both of these names are taken together because they are very near each other, relatively speaking, and both of them are accessible from Aurangabad. But Ajanta is much earlier. Ajanta starts around 2nd century BC and ends around 6th, almost getting up to 7th century CE. And as Ajanta ends, Ellora starts. So Ellora starts somewhere around 5th century CE and ends at around 11th century CE. That's first thing. Second, Ajanta is more famous for its paintings. That's not to say that there are no paintings in Ellora. I'll be talking to you about some of the paintings of Ellora too. But it's not that Ajanta is more famous for its paintings. Since this is not on Ajanta, I'm just going to say one sentence and leave it at that. Ajanta, in my opinion, is the oldest modern paintings in the world. I will not clarify that. We can do that later or when you meet me personally, either of the two. And as Ajanta ended, Ellora started, as I told you, but Ellora is more famous for its architecture. And although we call both these places as Ajanta Caves and Ellora Caves, it's a misnomer because there aren't any caves here. So somebody cheated you if you've been here. Because caves are natural caverns in the rock, and none of these are natural. These are all man-made. So rock-cut temples or rock-cut monuments would be proper terminology. Now, different monuments can be interpreted in different ways. These are some of the ways you can interpret it. One is mythological. There are so many myths associated with the monuments, as not only monuments, places, events, etc., etc. So one is a mythological, historical, architectural, geographical, which I'll show you. Location also makes a difference. Aesthetical, philosophical, and so many other ways you can interpret the same monument. I'm going to give you a small thing because we have very limited time here. So I'm just going to take some of the aspects. Philosophical aspect is something that I'm not going to cover in this thing because obviously, you know, there's not much of a time. And as I would say that a guide is always a jack of all and master of none, but I'm trying to work towards jack of all and master of at least some, if not none, at least some. So let's try to work it that way. Now, once upon a time is the theme that was there. So myths are the mists arising out of history, quote unquote. It's a beautiful saying. I don't know who said it, but it's very beautiful. The myths are mists arising out of history. History is actually stated in the facts. And when that facts get exaggerated, hyperboles, etc., come in, then it becomes a myth. So there are some myths about Ellora cave number 16, which is the Kailash, which is the biggest monolithic temple in the world. We'll be talking about that. It is said, thus I have heard. I would like to start with thus I have heard, because that's a famous Buddhist way to start any talk. So thus I have heard that there was this Elapur, and the king had two queens, and the queen had one of the younger queen actually was very great devout of Shiva. So she makes a beautiful temple of Shiva with a beautiful golden kalash or the finial. And so all the people in Ellora would go there and say, oh, wow, Hail the queen, hail the younger queen, hail the younger queen, because she's made such a fantastic temple with such a beautiful finial. And so the obviously, when you have two wives, always the elder wife always gets a little jealous. So she goes and complains, king, king, this is not fair. If everybody is singing her praise, nobody is singing my praise. So I want my own temple. And to pressurize king, she actually says, I'm going to fast until death. If I have to die, I'll die. But I will fast till the time I see the finial of my temple built by me. And so the king is in a problem. So what does he do? So king has some minister like, if you want, like Tenali Rama or Birbal or, I don't know, Merlin the Wizard, somebody, some wise chap. And he says, okay, king, don't worry. So he sends artists on the top of the mountain nearby, and he removes the loose rock and makes the finial out of it. Beautiful finial out of it. And then they show it to the queen. Queen, here is a finial. And she says, but where is my temple? You promised me finial, but where is my temple? She says, that was not a promise. The deal was, you see the finial. And now that you've seen the finial, you should break your fast, and the temple will happen in due course of time. Well, it took a lot of time. I'm not very sure whether the queen was alive by the time it happened. So this is one of the myths. There are many other myths. Other myth is that, I'll take one more and that I'll wrap it up on that, because as the last line says, facts of Ellora are more fascinating than the fiction, but just, I can't help this. Indra, court, he had very beautiful apsaras and the courtesans, and their job was obviously to dance and, you know, entertain everybody. And he, of late, he was noticing that every day, the reporting time maybe was 9 o'clock in the morning, like office time, and they were getting late every day. So he was upset. He says, why are you late every day? Oh, king, but there is so beautiful. This is so beautiful. There's a beautiful temple at Ellora. So we go there every day, and it's so beautiful that we get lost in it and we become always late. So Indra says, no, nothing doing. You're getting paid for your job. So you can do that in the night time. And in the morning, 10 o'clock, I want everybody here. Okay, so they say, okay, but if you don't come, I will curse you. You will become stones. So it is said that they went to in the night again, but they again got lost. They lost the track of time. And by the time they started flying up in the sky, lo and behold, there was sunlight. And then they were stuck on the temple. So if you go to Kailash temple and have a look at the upper part of the Kailash temple, cave number 16, you will see so many flying figures with the others, apsaras and Gandharvas, etc. there. And so those are stuck from that time. So this is another wonderful myth. There are many myths, but for that, you'll have to come to Aurangabad and then we'll tell you about the myths. Well, facts, as I told you, as it's written here, are more fascinating than fiction. And that's where we are going to get into that. So historically, Ellora caves are made between, as I told you, 5th to 11th century CE. Buddhists were made during the Chalukyas of Vatapi, Badami. That's also a World Heritage Monument, beautiful place. And I've been there, love to go there again. And Hindu and Jain were made during Rashtrakuta. Of course, there are other, this is a standard historical thing, but then there are other different opinions, like Kalachuri and Shilahar also could have contributed to that. But we'll leave it at that. Well, since there are three religions here, Buddhist, Hindu, and Jain, I would like to call this place as Jerusalem of India, with a difference, because in case of Jerusalem, you got a lot of interfaith animosity. Even today, you'll see there's a lot of fight going on. But when you come to Ellora and India, things are pretty cool. You know, all the religions are living peacefully besides each other. And the most interesting thing is that although these are different religions, you'll find the dynasty that was ruling in that area was mostly Hindus. So syncretism is not something that is new to India. Syncretism was there long time back. And of course, more information will be available when you come here. Next place. So when you talk about monolithic monuments, as some of you already know, some of you who do not, there are two types in it. The most common ones are two types. The most common one is to your left side. You can see here, this is called cut in monolith. Now, cut in monolith is something that is, you'll see everywhere. It's vertical surface. Can you see that this vertical surface is exposed? And then you start carving from front to back like this inside. You start carving from front to back. if you want X and Z axis. And so this is cut in monolith, but cut in monolith is not there only in India. It's there outside India too. For example, Abu Simbel in Egypt, Petra in Jordan, as you can see here, Duhong in China. There are so many places in the world, but there is a fundamental difference between what you have there and here. That is the material. Because when you talk about Petra, Abu Simbel, Dumhong, these are all sandstones, and many other places, it's also volcanic tuff. We'll not go into that for obvious reasons. And that's relatively easier to cut. But when you come to Ajanta, Ellora, and all those things, these are basalt. So it's a different ballgame altogether. Now, this is a cut in monolith, which is something that I think people who are in Mumbai, they know Elephanta and so many other places, you'll see that. But Ellora is separately nominated as a World Heritage Monument from Ajanta for the second type of monolithic architecture that started in India for the first time in the world and reached its highest level. And that is called cut out monolith. Now here you can see the example of cut out monolith. These are the churches of Lalibela in Ethiopia. These are, of course, are made much later times. 12th century, much later times, last millennium. And so you can see here, the horizontal surface is exposed. Can you see this is horizontal surface is exposed, and you start excavating, removing this all rock and creating the space. So mind you, the spaces in both these places that you take for granted, you know, you cannot take it for granted. And so that is why monolithic architecture is a very interesting thing. We'll talk more about it when we go to the Kailash. So this is just one of the things that we have here. Okay. So this I was talking about, this is a basaltic rock. This Deccan, these are called Deccan traps. Traps are not actually English traps. This is Germanic, Dutch Germanic. It actually probably relates to trepan, means steps. If you carefully look at this slide, can you see there are almost these horizontal lines are there? And these are called the traps, and these are basaltic traps. So it has got a very peculiar structure, which I will not go into it obvious for obvious reasons, but that actually explains the nature of the monument also. So geology is a very important aspect when you talk about monolithic architecture. And then where you make it is very important too. For example, if you look at the second slide, I am not sure whether you see it very clearly, but if you zoom in, probably you'll see there are so many trade routes that are crisscrossing. Right from this, actually, if you go up here, this even it joins to the traditional Silk Route. That's Marco Polo from Mediterranean to China, and then around in Uzbekistan, it takes a right turn. It goes through Peshawar and Lahore and all those places. It goes through Ujjaini and then comes to Ajanta, Ellora, and it goes further down south. So most of these monuments, most of the famous temples, you'll find them always around the trade routes, because trade routes are very important, not so much from, not only from the point of view of sponsorship, but also from the point of view of spreading the word of the religion, etc., etc., etc. So this is the amygdaloidal basalt, as you can see. Amygdules are the small holes, which I will not elaborate again. Now look at the layout of Ellora Caves. When you talk about Ellora Caves, there are 34 caves that are numbered, and around 70 caves without number, which are not even mentioned in this slide. They are all over the place, and they are very small. It has got its own peculiarity, but they are not as grand and as fantastic as you see here. See, as you can see here, 1 to 12 are Buddhist, 13 to 29 are Hindu, and 30 to 34 are Jaina caves. So there's three religions, so hence the Jerusalem term that I have used to describe this monument, with a Jerusalem with a difference. It looks like a very grotesque lobster or something, or maybe scorpion, but then, well, that is it. So there are three religions here. So let's start with the Jain section deliberately, because I want, you know, many times when people come to Ellora, people many times don't go to this section. They feel that it's not really very important. Of course, it's not as grand as you see cave number 16, of course, but then every place has its own peculiarity and beauty. So I will not be able to bring out the whole thing, but I'm just going to give you a cursory view. Now you can see this is cave number 32 and 33. So this is cave number 32 and this is cave number 33. Now, if you have not really understood, people who are not, especially when I have students which are not, who are not understood the meaning of cut in and cut out monolith, here it gets very much clarified. Can you see here this vertical surface? See, look at this. This is vertical surface exposed. All the rock in the front has been removed. So all the vertical surface has been exposed and then start carving from front to back. So this is the standard version. And so this is actually the cut in monolith. And then here, first time you are able to see here that cut out monolith. Now again, when you talk about cut out monolith is there in India, not only at Ellora, but there are at least 5 places that I know of where you have cut out monolith. I will not list them right now, but Ellora has of course the biggest cut out monolith here. Now if you carefully look at this, you will see there is a Mahadwar or the door here, all out of a single rock. There is a Dvajastambha, or if you go to Jaina temples, you will always see one pillar. You will not see 2 pillars. And so that is how you will see. Okay, so let's go further closer. When you go closer inside, as soon as you enter this door, this is what you are going to see. There is a central shrine here. This is 4-door shrine. Now this is very interesting because 4-door shrine in the texts, but in text it is written 4-door shrine can be made only for Shiva and Jaina. It cannot be made for any other god. And that's how you can actually see the implementation of that. You can see elephant here and a column, the Dvajastambha, as you see here. Now, many times people, symmetry is a very important aspect. So you see an apparent loss in symmetry, but in my opinion, that loss is actually notional, because here, since there is supposed to be only one column, to aesthetically balance this column, you have used equal volume of rock in terms of the elephant. So that's how you try to balance the whole monument. That is what, this is a beautiful upper view. Cut in monolith, cut out monolith, as you can see, these are all inside, you've got shrines. And here in the center here, it's not empty. In the center here, there is four direction facing Buddha-like figure. Okay, all the Jaina images, those who have been to Jaina temples always look like Buddha, and vice versa. There is a reason for that, but I'll not get into that. At the end of this, if you want to ask question, we'll get into that, because I don't know how much time do I have for this whole presentation. So within this, I have to finish it. So this is a typical Jain shrine at Ellora. Now cave number 32 that we saw, it's not a single temple. It's actually a cluster of multiple shrines. This is a shrine. This is another shrine. The bottom here, there is another shrine. There is a small shrine here. There is another shrine here. So these are different shrines that have been probably excavated by different sponsors. Now each of the shrine has the same layout. So once I describe it in one place, it's going to be same everywhere. For example, let's start with the sanctum. Look at him. Does he not look like a Buddha? But this is actually a Jaina Tirthankar. And you can identify the Tirthankars by their symbol, or their lakshana, or lanchana, as we call it. Lanchana is used in negative terms, but it's not really that. So you can see lion here. And the moment you see a Buddha image and a naked Buddha image, these are all, by the way, these Jaina shrines are all dedicated to Digambar sect. And so Digambar sect, as you know, is the monks who do not wear any clothes at all, even today. And so when you see that, and then you see lion, this is the Mahavira. Now each of the Tirthankar, or each of the, I will not call it prophet, because there are no prophets, there is no god, there is no god that is actually accepted as a creator in Buddhism and Jainism, so hence there is no prophet, but for simplicity I'll still call him prophet. Each of them will have one male and one female assistant on both the sides. So on his right and our left, you'll see somebody sitting on an elephant. And so, do I see it somewhere else? Ah, yeah, you can see here. He's sitting here at the elephant, at the sanctum, you will see that. You can see, and he's called Matanga. Now, Britishers, when they came here at Jaina Caves, they saw this image first time, and they thought that since there is elephant, it is obviously Indra. Hence, they called this place as Indra Sabha. It is not really Indra, it is Matanga. And then, on the left side, you will actually see here, you can see here, she is, to his left side, our right side, she is Siddhika, always mounted on the lion. There is a controversy here. Some people say Ambika, Siddhika, but then usually we call it her Siddhika. And then after that, to the right side of the sanctum. See, this is the Matanga here. So to the right side of the sanctum and to our left side on the side walls, you will always see this image. What happened? Okay, so you'll always see this image, and this is image of Bhagwan Parshvanath. Bhagwan Parshvanath. He is number 23. There are, as you know, there are 24 Tirthankars or the holy Buddha. I would say Buddhas. There are 24 Buddhas in Jainism, you could say, because please remember, Buddha is not name of any particular person. It's just a title for an enlightened person. So he is Jainata Bhagwan Parshvanath, born about 250 years before him. So if you really look at it, Jainism is much older than Buddhism. And Digambar, and he's always identified by the seven-hooded cobra behind his head. So these are the people who are trying to stop him from meditation, and he's being protected by the seven-hooded cobra, and that becomes his identification sign, Bhagwan Parshvanath. And on the other side of the same wall, you will always see this gentleman. His name is Bahubali. He's also called Gomateshwar. If you go to Karnataka, that's one of my favorite places. You see 57 feet high image of Bahubali Gomateshwara. I believe this year there was probably, I don't know if I'm right, but then this year there was Mahamastakabhishek, which happens every 12 years. Now what you see here is he is actually meditating for 12 years, 14 years, some people say, but 12 years, some people say. And he was meditating in 12 years. So he was so engrossed in meditation that the vines grew around his body. And so that becomes his identification sign. So when you see a Buddha-like image with the vines around his body, safely conclude he is Bhagwan Bahubali Gomateshwar. There is a beautiful story associated with him. But maybe if we have time later, I'll tell you that. This is his elder brother Bharat. And his these two are his sisters, Brahmi and Sundari. Okay. So the next slide, as we already seen that. So let's go further. Now, as I told you, there are paintings in Ellora too. And of course, there are sculptures in Ajanta. But both of them are different. Now, these are typically timed around 10th to 11th century. If you look at these are typically timed around 10th to 11th century in Jaina caves. And those of you who have seen Ajanta paintings, you will realize that these paintings are not really that great. They are almost... don't want to say that, but almost juvenile compared to what you see in Ellora, Ajanta, what you see Ajanta. In my personal opinion, the emphasis later time shifted from painting to sculpting. Of course, there are reasons which we'll obviously not get into, but you can see this is beautiful painting of probably Bhagwan Parshvanath. You can barely see the seven hooded cobra here. Here, there is a ceremony that's being carried out. We call it Kesha Loach ceremony, where you actually, Jaina monks are not supposed to keep hair. They are not supposed to shave it. They are supposed to pull their hair out. I know it sounds very painful. Well, ladies who are looking at this might realize that because they do the epilation also, the waxing. And they also have a waxing technique, in the sense they don't use wax those days. But they would use hot ash, put it on their head like this, because the hair follicles are embedded in our skin by the small fat globule, and the fat becomes little plastic, and then you can pull it off easily. But I still don't want to do it. Those of you who would like to, try it. This is again beautiful photograph of cave number 32. Absolutely amazing details. For example, if you look at this bracket figure, this is just a bracket figure. Now you might wonder, what's the big deal about bracket figure? Now he's blowing a conch. This is a conch in his hand. He's blowing a conch. And if you go near it, and there are many such figures, when you go near it, you'll actually see his cheeks are puffed like this. And the eyes are bulging out. So that actually has been done here. So it go, they, you know, there was a, somebody said, I don't know who said, quote unquote, again, they work like titans and finish like jewelers. So I think this is apt for describing Ellora and many of its caves and monuments. So these are incomplete Jaina caves. Now, incomplete caves, in my opinion, are very important, even in Ajanta or in Ellora or so many other places, because they give you an insight of how they approach the architecture. So when I have architecture students, we have long sessions in these places. This is a incomplete cut in monolith, cave number 30A. This is Jaina again, and this is incomplete 30B, or Chota Kailash as it is called. It is actually, you can see the spaces are created and then how they work on it. That's where I try to explain. What, not so much the water, water is actually accentuating it. You'll see that this courtyard that you see here is not natural. So it's not only the insides of the caves and the facade that you see here, even the courtyard has to be excavated. This is a hard basalt rock. So trust me, it is tough to do that. And that's the reason Ellora stands out of all the monolithic monuments you see everywhere, anywhere in the world. Okay, so let's go to the Buddhist caves now. Let me also have a look at the time. I am doing with the time. I think we are okay. I'll take some few more minutes of your time. There is a difference between Buddhism at Ajanta and Ellora. In Ajanta, you will see the Buddhism is Hinayana or Theravada and Mahayana. Theravada is, you could say, an iconic, and Mahayana is iconic. But in Ellora, the Buddhism is becomes slightly even more refined, which is called Vajrayana, or it is also called Tantric Buddhism, Tantric form of Buddhism. Hence, the iconography in Ellora becomes much different from Ajanta. Again, for the details, we will not go into that. Lack of Jatak Katha, you see Jatak Katha or the stories of Buddha in a painting of Ajanta. Of course, no paintings are surviving. Of course, in some of the Buddhist caves in Ellora were painted, but none of them are surviving. There are three-storied viharas that you see in Buddhist caves in Ellora, whereas in Ajanta, you at the most see two. And I don't know of too many places where you have three-storied. I think there is one in Andhra Pradesh, Udavalli caves. There are three-storied, almost going to fourth stories. Presence of tantric divinities, which I will show you later, but not talk too much about it because it's a very interesting subject. It's a very deep subject. There are living quarters in Chaitya. When you go to Ajanta, you will see Chaityas will have only the what do you call it, stupas and the places of worship. We'll talk about that in a while. 11 viharas and only one Chaitya. And in my opinion, that's probably the best Chaitya that I have ever seen in my life. Okay, so this is the only Chaitya at Ellora. Cave number 10, you can see this is the facade. Now, when you go to Ajanta, you will only see the hall, worshipping hall. This is the worshipping hall. This is the only thing you will see. This is the same architecture everywhere. You'll see this when you go inside. In Ajanta, you will only see this. But on the sides here and here, there are many rooms here for the monks to stay, which will be absent in Ajanta. Now again, in Ajanta, you will see the facade will have this typical, these are called Chaitya window. Can you see this window? Barely you can make this window. This is actually Gavaksha. Gavaksha word probably comes from Gau Aksha. Aksha is eye. Gau is cow, cow's eye. And so it's actually also a sort of people-shaped, people leaf or the ficus religiosa leaf shape. And so that is the typical identification of a Chaitya. You'll usually not see this in any vihara, facade of any vihara. You'll only see this in Chaitya. And so that's one more difference. Now, Chaitya, as soon as you go inside, you will see the most important thing in a Chaitya is not the Buddha's image. This is not important at all. The most important is what you see here. That is the stupa. Stupa is a funerary mound that is after death of any important Buddhist or Buddha, the body is burned, the ashes are collected, and those ashes are supposed to be buried inside. There aren't any ashes in Ajanta or Ellora because, well, it's a monolith. So, but then it's more symbolic. There are four types of stupas. Again, we are not going to get into that. But this is Mahayanic, almost 7th century, as it's written, dated around 7th century. So here Buddha images are there. Now, this is very unusual. You'll see Buddha is sitting here in the what we call as Pralamba Pada Asana or hanging leg position. Many times in Ajanta, you will see that only in cave number 16 and probably 26 and 16. And I think one more other cave that you will see this pose. But this usually indicates the later phase of Buddhism. And his hand gesture is very important, which I cannot show you because the slides would have been too many. So this hand gesture is, I'll show you in the on the camera here. Okay, so this is the hand gesture. You can see the hand gesture. This is the hand gesture. This is called Dhamma Chakra Pravartana Mudra, or the teaching pose of Buddha, where he actually tells you the essence of Buddha's teaching, which again is beyond the scope right now. One of the most important thing about is that if you look at the face of Buddha, which I'm going to show you in the next slide, you will see he's so serene and sublime. So, you know, many a times, time and again, I am reminded that these places are not made by the people working from 9 to 5, waiting for the paycheck at the end of the month. These are people, of course, money is needed. You need money, but that was not their ultimate aim. They were not here to become billionaires. They were just living. They were there to explain, express themselves in such a beautiful manner. And so I'm going to show you that too. So, and the acoustics is so beautiful that I have seen people going in trance. In my life, I have seen people going in trance. And I'm told one of my senior colleagues here was here with Pandit Bhimsen Joshi. And when he came here, and he couldn't just bear with it, and he just started singing, and he sang so beautifully. I have seen that happening time and again. So this is, there are certain things you cannot explain in the words, which have to be experienced. So this is a place of experience. Now all the chaityas will have stupa and the Buddha image, or sometimes not, but architecture will be exactly same. This is called barrel shape roof, apsidal backside, or in Sanskrit we will call it gaja prushthakruti. Gaja is elephant, prushtha is the back, akruti is the shape. Gaja prushthakruti, the, or the shape of the back of the elephant. And so some people say inverted boat. These are the ribs that you see here are the duplication of the wooden architecture you would normally have. If you go to Ajanta, you'll see wood, but wood they realize doesn't work very well, especially when there is rains and water seepage. So they did everything in stone in the later phase. And that's how you can see it here. So let's go to the next slide. Look at this. This is a photo I have taken probably 2014 or 15 or something like that, something long time back. Now there is one day every year in March where the sunlight directly falls on Buddha's face. Now, how can I describe this? I just want you to feel this. There is no description for this. Just feel this serenity on Buddha's face. It's just for 3 minutes. After 3 minutes, light goes away. So I was fortunate to be there. So this is one of my favorite photographs of Buddha. Now let's go to cave number 12, which is a complete vihara. It's completed vihara. 11 is also three-story, but it is actually a completed vihara. It looks very Spartan, very simple, because this, according to some people, is supposed to be a hostel for the students. Well, those who have stayed in hostels, you know how drab and how simple they can be. They are never flowery hostels. Don't be fooled by the simplicity of this. There are rooms inside, there are Buddha images inside. And this actually is a top floor, which many people consider is it as a classroom. This is the inside of the classroom. And there's a huge hall, which I'm not able to show you here right now, because I'm going to do one thing. I'm going to do my own photography. Now that I've learned that such things can happen. So I'm going to do my own photography and then maybe make something else some other time. But you can see here so many Buddha images are there. These are called Dhyani Buddhas, or the meditating Buddhas. I'm not going to describe the pantheon because it's take a long time. Each of these can be identified. Although they look exactly same, each of them can be identified by the tree under which they get enlightened. And that tree in turn is identified by looking at the shape of the leaf of the tree. And hence we can understand which all these are there. But this is a beautiful place, actually, on the top floor. Well, these are the Vajrayanic Shaktis or Devis. As you can see, these are the Tantric Devis that you see here. You can identify each of them. She is Tara, and then she is Vajradhatveshwari, etc., etc. Those who are into Tibetan Buddhism. Now, this is almost contemporary or a little bit before Tibet got its Buddhism. So iconographically, this is a great work has been done by Dr. R.S. Gupte. I must mention him. In trying to compare the Tibetan Buddhism and finding its roots in Ellora. So Saddharma, Pundarik, etc. have been studied. And so these are the Taras that, and the different goddesses that you will actually find, which you will never find in Ajanta. So this is one more difference that you'll see. Let's go to the final Hindu caves. There are many Hindu caves, so let's look at the final. All are dedicated to Shiva. And one of the names, by the way, for the Kailash temple is Guheshwar. We'll come to that later. And from 7th to 9th century. So when I say 7th to 9th century, that does not mean that it did not start at 669 or 599. You have to give a little bit of time. It's about 50-100 years here and there. So contributions, official version says contributions of Rashtrakutas. And we'll be looking at cave number 21, aka Rameshwar. Oh, it's beautiful small cave. Cave number 29, Dumarleni, because this actually is very, very closely related to the Elephanta Caves. So those who have been to Elephanta Caves, especially my Bombay colleagues, since you have not been able to show the complete story and beautiful sculptures there, I'm going to fill that up by showing you cave number 29 at Ellora. And of course, the Kailash, that goes without saying. Okay, so next. So this is actually the cave number 21, where you all the Shiva temples, you'll always see a Nandi here. And here this is Lajja Gauri. We'll not get to that again. This is a small cave, very simple, but this is the beautiful sculpture of Ganga standing on Makara. And then look at her headgear. Now headgear in this cave is absolutely phenomenal. Every sculpture has got a different headgear. So many times I'm told that filmmakers making period films come here and copy the hairstyle. So those who are into hairstyle, you can try to look at that and you can see these are the Sapta Matrikas, or seven mother goddesses. Okay, and everyone will have a different hairstyle and style here. This is probably the most beautiful Nataraja that I have ever seen in Ellora, cave number 21. Most beautiful Nataraja. Actually, I cannot show it here, the details, but this flute player expression is absolutely prize-worthy. It's beautiful. And you can see this Sapta Matrikas here. And at the end, you will see Ganesha here. And here in front wall, opposite Nataraj, you will see Kal, or the death. Shiva as a death, Kalari Shiva. So that you'll see. Actually, here you can see this. Some people say this is a dance of creation and this is a dance of death, because Shiva is both creator and a destroyer. As I told you, we are not going to get into the philosophical aspect, so we'll leave it at that. Cave number 29. This is the place, Dumarleni, or it is called 20. It is actually very similar to your Elephanta Caves. Considered to be the oldest Hindu caves. I'm not very sure about that, but then officially it's said the Hindu caves, because the sculptures here are not really that refined that you see in Jaina and Kailash and many other places. They are slightly bulky and little. And actually, I showed you the best Nataraj. If you want to see the worst Nataraj ever, you can go into cave number 29. So you can see that, but that actually puts things in perspective. The beautiful things that we take for granted, they're supposed to be beautiful, you realize that it has to be attempted to be beautiful. And of course, that's another thing. I'm not going to show you that. Okay, so guys, this is a picture taken by me. Now, can you see this is so similar to Elephanta? This is Elephanta, this is Cave number 29. Both of these will have four-door temple. Remember, four-door temple is only for Shiva and Jaina, nobody else. And so you can see very similar architecture here. And the stories also are there. In Elephanta, actually, there are a couple of stories are not there in cave number 29, which are there in Elephanta. Then this is the Andhakasur. This is probably one of the best ones here. Look at this. The expression is exquisite, full of aggression. That's one of the reasons why people go all the way to cave number 29. Of course, there is a beautiful waterfall in the monsoon. The rest of the time, it's all dry. See, it's only fall. There is no water there because we are a drought-prone area. So it's only fall, no water there. So here you can actually see that. Look at this. Full aggression. Andhakasur is being killed here. And so I'm not going to talk to you the detailed stories. Then again, you can see this is one more popular thing. Ravan challenging Shiva by lifting the mountain, and Shiva puts his foot down and Ravan is trapped underneath this, and he has to say sorry. And well, Shiva is always forgiving. He says, okay, don't do it again, and you are forgiven. Then you have Shiva Parvati playing game of dice. You'll see many of these in Elephanta also. Now we come to the final thing, the cave number 16, the Kailash. It's the epitome of monolithic architecture. Not simply because it is the biggest monolithic temple in the world. It is simply because it is, I just don't get it. How do you possibly imagine to do something like this? That is the reason. The very fact that somebody thought that this was possible and somebody thought that it's worth doing it. Now imagine those who are into sales and who have been corporates. Now imagine you have a project and you are the salesman. This is the height of salesman. Now you go to the King Krishna first, who's Krishna first. I got this fantastic plan, a single monolith. Hello, am I audible? Can somebody just...
Yes, sir, you are.
Thank you. Thank you. So point is, imagine somebody makes a sales pitch saying that King Krishna first, I have made this fantastic plan. Nobody in the world has even imagined making such plan. And I want you to sponsor it so that you will live forever because of this plan. And so there's only two problems with this, sir. Two problems with this project, sir. The first problem is that nobody has done something like this before on this scale. Okay. And second thing is, and you are not going to see it finished. It's not going to be finished in your time. And I still want you to pay for it. How do you make sales pitch for that? And somebody did. And King Krishna was convinced and he thought it was worth sponsoring. So hail both of them. And that's the reason the Kailash is the biggest monolithic temple. Also known as Kailashnath, Manakeshwar, Guheshwar, different names. Now, when you talk about monolithic monuments, you have to understand that it is a negative way of working. What do I mean by that? You are used to doing certain things in a way. For example, I don't know is a phrase, or I love you. Most popular phrase. So if you are supposed to, you cannot say it like this. You have to say it, you love I. Or you have to say it opposite way. It's almost asking an athlete to run backwards and win the race. It's as complex as that. And here comes my punchline, patented, joking, that monolith means there is no second chance. You cannot go wrong. So all the planning of human resource, finance, it's impossible. When you go there, you start realizing how small you are. And every time I feel crushed when I go to Kailash cave number 16, but I feel very happy being crushed. I feel very happy being small there. So do go there. Those who have not been there, you are missing. Don't die before going to Ajanta and Ellora. Don't die that before doing that. And so, well, I should give you some numbers. If you want numbers here, approximately 276 feet in length, 154 feet in breadth, and 107 feet in depth, which actually translates to approximately 200,000 tons of rock and 3 million cubic feet of rock to be excavated. And that's not the only thing that you're supposed to do there. There are a lot of details, which obviously I'm not going because I think I am transcending the time limit that was given to me here. So approximately 7,000 people worked on it. Imagine those of you who are industrialists and managing things. Now, if you have 12, 20 people, 30 people, the challenges involved in managing people, you can actually see that. But here, you're supposed to manage 7,000 people at that time. And that is the reason it actually makes a total difference here. Now, this is the facade. As you try to get into the cave number 16, now all the people that you stand here, this is all the courtyard is actually not natural. It has been created. As soon as you enter, you see this Gajalakshmi. I could go on telling you about this Gajalakshmi, but I think you should come to Ellora, and all my guide colleagues will be most happy to tell you about the greatness of this monument. So, by the way, Ellora guides are supposed to be good. Huh? Okay, look at this. This is actually the Gajasamhara Murthy killing the elephant shaped this thing. Aggression here is also very nicely put. This is Kaal. It's scary. And that's the purpose. Vivid's portrait in the sculptures here. Now, this is one of the pictures that have been taken here. You can see this is a huge pillar. Some people say Dvajastambha, Manastambha. On top of this here, there is actually a broken Trishul. And that indicates that this temple belongs to Shiva. In ancient texts of sculpting or temple making, it is very clearly written that whosoever temple you make, the weapon of the presiding deity should be visible from a great distance. And so that's how you can actually see being implemented here. There would be Mahabharata here, bits and pieces of Mahabharata here. It's not really very well done. But again, you can see some white patches here. This whole temple was plastered and painted 3 times in and out. And what you're seeing right now is 18th century, by whom we very reverently mention as Punya Shlok Ahilya Devi Holkar, the Queen of Indore. This was not in her kingdom, but still she put her own money to upkeep of this temple and so many temples in whole of India. So we are ever grateful to her. Look at this. Beautiful picture. These elephants are almost supporting the whole temple. And this is an unsupported cantilever. Those who are in engineering, well, this is your nightmare in applied mechanics and strength of material. It's actually hanging here. It's about 24 feet across. And there is 72 feet of rock on top of that. Okay. I'm not going to talk more about this. Well, this is a beautiful aisle. And in fact, actually, if you stand near this particular column, and if you look at this, it's absolutely in a straight line. Every column hides behind each other at this line. So they have done and I want you to keep on reminding yourself that this is a monolith. So the spaces that you see here, everywhere, every square foot of a cubic foot of space that you see here, that you are taking for granted because you are used to making built monuments. You cannot take it for granted here. You have to execute it that way. Okay. So this is Ramayana, 8 lines, compressed Ramayana. I could tell you from here, but now is not the time. So just remember, if you are the artist, you should know your Ramayana well. You should choose your characters very carefully. And mind you, you got only one chance to do that. This is some of the top views of Kailash. Beautiful light has come here. And this 4 lions are there here, which actually is here. It's this part small, you see small thing here. These are the 4 lions, beautiful. There are engineering aspects of these lions. If I engineers and architects, we deal with them. There it comes. This is the bird's eye view. Fantastic bird's eye view. This is probably the last slide that I have. So thank you for your patience, but look at this. If you draw a plumb line here, mind you, this is more than 300 feet. Draw a plumb line here. You'll see it's a perfectly straight line and symmetry. And so doing this project at this scale and still achieving it, to me, it's a miracle, nothing short of a miracle. That's the reason, you know, this is just a myth that has come true. Of course, on the side, you can also see here some other things that are being made. This is another cutout monolith that is being made, but of course, incomplete. And since we have very limited time, this is the end of the starters. So these were just starters, people. This was not the main meal. Main course of this meal will begin when you come here. Apart from this, we have a lot of things on menu card, such as Daulatabad Fort, Bibi Ka Maqbara, Mini Taj. It's not so many, it's still 60% of Taj. Lonar, the biggest meteorite crater in the world. Actually, NASA comes to do research there because the pH, those who are science students, the pH of this is eerily almost 11. It's highly alkaline. No fish can survive, only certain plants can survive. So NASA comes to look at that and study that. Well, there are many more cookies and toffees lying around Aurangabad. So I invite all of you to come to Aurangabad and see through the eyes of the Aurangabad guides. And so all Aurangabad guides, we've got many language guides. So we'll be able to help you a lot. Thank you very much for your patience. And so if something, of course, a lot of things are missing, but if something is wrong, so please forgive me. And I think here I end. Parul, over to you now, I think.
Yeah, thank you. So there are some questions in the chat box. I'll read it for you.
Please.
Mr. Kapil is asking, what about the 200,000 tons of rock removed because nothing seems to have been disposed in the near vicinity?
Yes, they must have been taken outside somewhere. In fact, actually, there was a small mound also lying around in front of that cave. And actually, if I may just continue on that, if I show you the Jain presentation again, you'll actually see when I showed you the courtyard, how it was being made, you'll see that they were not randomly chipping off the rock. They were trying to remove the rock in the form of slabs. or geometrical shapes. So you could, so that you could use those somewhere else as a building material. So theoretically, Kapil, you can make two monuments out of this. One monolith and one built right in front. So you could say that it's a very funny building where you don't bring building material inside, but you take it out. Okay. So I hope I answered the question. Yes, please. Next.
Yes, Mr. Daya, sorry, Daya, I have asked in Kal and Bhairav are both forms of Shiva, or yeah. They are different.
They are different. Bhairav will always be identified with a dog, although both of them are naked, but Bhairav will be in human form and he'll be usually be accompanied with a dog.
Aditya Shekhar has asked in, what is the importance of Dhwaja Stambh here?
Sorry, it is breaking up. I didn't hear that, sorry.
What's the importance of Dhwaja Stambh here?
Dhwaja Stambh.
Some people say Dhwaja Stambh, I would also like to call it Mana Stambh. It is actually, and later on it became Deepa Stambh. In later 18th century onwards, if you look at the temples, you'll see they converted into Deepa Stambh, small lights being this thing. So every god or every place will have their own Dhwaja or the identification mark. But as I told you, you can see a Trishul on that. And don't quote me, but I'm not too sure, but I think it is Prasada Mandan, the book. Actually mentions that the weapon of the presiding deity should be visible from a great distance to add, so that you identify whose temple is it, and that's how that is. These are all speculations, nothing is written here. So if you want to speculate something else and justify it, you're free to do that. Any other question?
I'm just scrolling down, I'll just check. Can you highlight some of the challenges being faced by the guides during the during and post COVID-19 and recovery strategy? Mr. Saurabh Krishnan has asked.
Well, I will have to do another webinar on that. I mean, if you are a guide, you know what challenges we are facing, right? Because it's already 8 months and absolutely not a single pie income. So anyway, that's not the subject here today. So let's skip that. Some other time in some other webinar.
I think we are done with the question array. Bhavna ma'am, over to you then.
Yeah, thank you so much, Amol. It was a beautiful presentation, exclusively on Ellora, and nicely put up, nicely presented. Thank you so much. And I hope our participants must have enjoyed this webinar. Thank you, Amol. Over to you, Parul.
People are requesting your email ID. If you can just put in your email ID.
Sorry. I'm extremely sorry. That's my last slide, actually. Oh, where is it? Oh, my God. Okay. Looks like I have messed it up on the last slide. That was supposed to be my last slide. It got edited, it seems. So I'm going to do one thing. I'm going to put...
You can just say it, Amol.
On the chat, so that okay, I can give you my telephone number. Okay, type message here. Okay, here I am. My name is AMODBASOLE, and then my email address is simple BASOLEAMOD, no gaps, @gmail.com, and then again my WhatsApp number would be, of course, 91 will be the India code, those who are from outside, and then you have 94221 0571. WhatsApp or contact number also is the same. So sorry, what did I do? Okay, so these are my details, 94221 0571. Well, hope enjoyed. Thank you. Thank everybody, and I hope it was enjoyable. Time well worth spent.